Turn to the book of Hebrews. No, I'm not going to start my course now on the book of Hebrews, but there is a scripture here I'd like to start with. And really, there's just this small section that I want to finish up from our last class that I didn't get to. But the bulk of this session is going to be, in fact, the name of it will be Redemption in Relation to Kind, Being of a Certain Kind. And we've been dealing with this subject of what is the kind of God and being after His kind. And we've been seeing that in relationship to doctrines such as reconciliation. We'll see it tonight in relationship to redemption and resurrection. And we begin to realize that if something is big on the heart of the Lord, it needs to be big on our hearts. A lot of times in a marriage relationship, the ones that work are the person sees what's big in the heart of the other person, and back and forth, you know. And same thing with the Lord, same thing. Not for any advantage, or not for any benefits, though seeking the Lord and knowing the Lord and loving the Lord from a pure heart and wanting the Lord, all of that does result in certain benefits and not a good word, but advantages, things that bless you and help you and this sort of thing. But the motivation has to be the Lord, that you want to know, you know, I want to know you, Jesus. I want to know you, Father. I want to know your essence and not just what your hands have done for me, because they have, you know, all of us. We've all been blessed and blessed and blessed. But this thing of kind is one of those things, I think. We saw that in the book of Genesis, and we won't reteach that. But here in Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 14, for we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. And of course, that can be read that, you know, like in light of salvation, but that's not really a salvation scripture. You know, partakers of Christ, if we hold our confidence steadfast to the end, we'll be saved. You know, if we hold on to Jesus as our Savior till the end, we'll be saved. Well, you know, there are other scriptures that may or may not refer to that, but certainly seem to say it better than this one. But this one is not salvation, but becoming a partaker of Christ, becoming of His kind. And in the last class, we were talking about that there is a good. There is Adam and Eve and the fallen creation. There is a good within man. There's also an evil there that comes from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And that man is capable of incredible good, and he is capable of incredible evil also. And it's just, you know, I use this phrase, it's not in the Bible, but it's just built into his DNA. And but true moral good, real as God understands it, not a moral or ethical standard such as Ten Commandments or whatever, but true moral good, that is not possible in us apart from God. not the one that he labels that. See, we would call that, we'd call that the good of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. I have that, you know. I mean, that's us right there. Oh, I have that, you know. Well, first of all, it's not possible in you apart from God, not what he's talking about. So I guess the bottom line is, folks, you need to get saved. No, it's more than that. You need to become a partaker of Christ. And if that's true that there is not the realm of that moral good as God understands it, except, and that be in us, except it be there by Christ, by the life of Christ within us, then it's also true that there's nothing that can be attributed to us unless, and here's, it's different, I'm going to say, there's nothing that can be attributed to us unless it is true in us. Okay. Now, that doesn't mean that it's not true to God in Christ, but it means that ultimately, all of God's reality is supposed to be in you by Christ. Notice I didn't say all of God's reality and standards and qualifications and everything is supposed to be in you. Well, you don't even have that capacity. You know, if there's none good but God, you're not God, then you're not good. Then the only moral good that you could ever really hold is Christ, and you hold him within your being, within your breast, and then it is true in you. Now, it's true in you for a couple of reasons. Number one, you're in Christ. Number two, Christ is in you. But it would be the desire of the Father that it be true in you in manifestation, not just because Jesus is in there. Okay. Hence, the Holy Spirit. That's why he's here. You know, he's forming Christ in us. Okay, he's forming Christ in us. And we talked about this last class, but it's possible to do good things for other people and yet that not really be consistent with who we really are, you know. We do it out of guilt. We do it to impress people. We do it, you know, and that's not everything we do, but that proves that there is something yet at work in us that is not Christ, that is not in that realm of being good, isn't even necessarily trying to please Christ, is trying to please others by making them be, you know, think that you're better than what you are, or you're trying to prove to yourself that you're not as bad as you know, though no one else may know, how that you're not that bad. So we do things to offset guilt. You know, well, y'all remember we talked about this, right? You know, this is part of our last two classes. In fact, it was pretty much the whole point of the last two classes. But there is that reality that what's true in Jesus is therefore true in you. And you see there's this tightrope that we walk between being in Christ and Christ in us. And that's the thing Jesus said. At that day you shall know this. And that day was not the day of salvation. That day was not the day you got baptized in the Holy Spirit. That day was not the day that he worked a miracle. That day was the day when God specifically came to you. At that day, you will know. And you can believe, if he's just talking to 12 disciples there, it's not all going to necessarily happen on the same day that they're going to know specifically I and you and you and me. They might all got saved on the, you understand what I'm saying? They might all got saved on the same day. But Jesus is talking about something else here than just those kind of encounters. He's talking about a specific day when a specific reality of relationship that to him is all important because that's what Jesus died to bring about. So we don't treat that like just a doctrine. We don't treat that like a teaching. We treat that like that is one of the treasures of God's heart. And Lord, I want to know your realities by life. And I don't want, you know, to slip it up into cruise control and just, you know, sit like this, you know, for a long time. Some people call that passivity. Anybody familiar with that term? Passivity. All right. So, what is the thing that makes all of this absolutely true? Well, it's different words, being a partaker of Christ, oneness, or being of his kind, being after his kind, by Christ. By Christ. Okay. So we talk about the bride, and I've written a book on it and everything, but you know, the bride doesn't become after his kind apart from him. You know, what we fail to remember is that she became after his kind. See, God made male and female of creatures and birds and everything. You know, male, da-da-da, female, da-da-da-da. He makes them. There it is. Okay. But he didn't do that with Adam and Eve in type and shadow of Christ and the bride. She didn't make herself after his kind. She was the work of God. You know, it talks about that in Colossians. You know, faith in the work of the cross. Faith in the work of God. And he, God, put Adam to sleep, opened up his side, and took part of Adam. Because that's his kind. Does that make sense? Then she could say, I'm part of your kind because I'm part of you. All right. So what's the conclusion of what I just said? The conclusion is, it's absolutely foolish to get in a frenzy over trying to be his kind when if you're born again, you are already taken out of his rib at the cross, as it were, and taken out of his side, and you are already what you seek to be. But there is that other dimension, and that is, I will send the Holy Spirit, and he will teach you me, and then you'll know who you are. Your identity will change. You will not just be you for me, you'll be me, Jesus speaking here, you'll be me out of me. Okay. That's the way God sees it. It's not a doctrine to Jesus. See, we have a doctrine of the cross. He doesn't. He actually died on that thing. He's not up there going, well, I believe this. You know, no, you're living it. You know. You're not just grabbing something out of the air and say, I choose to believe that. You have to go into that death with him. You know what I'm saying? In knowledge, in understanding, by the power of the Spirit of God to reveal the resurrected Christ and the crucified Christ, and out of that, the resurrection. All right. So we want to talk about this this thing of kind in relationship to redemption, and that's probably a good thing because the name of the class is Redemption Truths, and therefore it would be good not just to spend our whole time on reconciliation. All right, turn with me if you would to the book of Psalm 111 and verse 1. Not really. No. So instead of dialing 911, I want you to dial 111. However, we will have a 9 in it because we're going to go to verse 9. He sent redemption unto his people. He hath commanded his covenant forever. Holy and reverend is his name. All right. He sent redemption to us in the person of Christ crucified. There was no redemption in a package that he gave to us, folks. There's no redemption in a package that he just sent to us. He sent redemption when he sent his son to die on a cross. Again, not a doctrine. With God, it is everything. With Jesus, it cost him his life. With the Father, it cost him his son. With them, it was never in the realm of religious knowledge. It is in the realm of God knowledge, which is the true meaning of the word theology. But it's more than that, because it's not just the study of God, it is God's knowledge. It is his view of these things. And only those who really pursue his heart will see him. That doesn't mean only those will get saved or all that kind of stuff. You know, that choice is left to us. You know, we can hang back, we can draw in. That's, you know, it's totally up to us. All right, so All right. We talked about reconciliation. All right, reconciliation being reconciliation relating primarily to kind. I'm just telling you, and you know, just because I'm saying it doesn't mean it's true. And just because I say it doesn't mean you need to, you know, listen to what I'm saying. But I'm telling you, there is no reconciliation without a true grasp of kind, because God will not be reconciled to something that is not after his kind. It's not going to happen. Okay? So we can doctrinalize it, and we can come up with all sorts of theological views of it, but only one thing matters to God, and that is kind. So here we have two circles with arrow in between pointing to both one another, and in fact probably the arrow should be one from this one here, one from that one here, and they're meeting, they are reconciled. They're not just getting along. In God's economy, the only way to get the Hatfields and the McCoys together, and the truth is, you know, but I mean, the only way is that somebody's either going to have to, you know, all of them are going to have to become Hatfields or McCoys. Now, the other way is, in God, is he takes Jew and Gentile, puts them in himself, crucifies them, and raises up one new man. You're familiar with Ephesians. Okay, so this thing with kind is really big. All right, so this right here, to become his kind now, and I really don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but I want to make sure that you understand this. And this is, okay, you got God over here, but it's not you in that other circle meeting up with God. You don't somehow become his kind. This over here is Jesus, and the difference between eternity past, where they're of the same kind, and now is that you and I are in him. Okay? In him. All right. So that makes you of his kind. So what does that do? What does that say? Well, it says every time we freak out about our failures, we're probably looking at us and not Jesus. See, I can't make any progress because you have to explain everything, but the different definition of that, I say that, but most people, if you say that, you know, well, the problem then, if you're freaking out, is you're probably looking at you and not at Jesus. In their mind, they would go, yes, amen, and they want to picture some sort of looking up to heaven and holding their hands out and looking at him sitting on a throne, you know, with sandals and a white robe, and you know, I'm with you now. That's not it. Maybe that'll help you to understand why it doesn't work. Well, I try to look at Jesus, and it doesn't work. You have to look at the one in whom you are. You have to look at the cross. You have to look at the resurrection, and the resurrection is Christ. And we'll get into that next week. But that's Jesus is God's answer. Okay, well, we go, yeah, because he came down here and he became a man and he did a bunch of great stuff, and because he did that great. No, he's not the answer man. What, the Shell answer man? Does anybody remember that commercial? You know, he's not the answer man. He's the answer. And only by finding God's reality. You know, here's what we say. Well, I don't really understand that. Or I don't really get that. You know, it's not your reality. It's God's. You know? I mean, it'd be like a husband and wife or a team working toward a goal, you know, and you got a team leader and he says, okay, we're going to do this, you know? And they go, I don't really get that. So, no. You kind of go, well, this is, you know, this is what we're going to do. You know, well, it's even more a big deal when it's God, you know. Anyway, all right, so when that kind thing by reconciliation, and this is reconciliation we're still talking about here, when that happens, it automatically, because you're one with him, you're in him, he's in you, you have been changed, the old you was put to death. And the new you is not a new you. The new you is a member of Christ. That's the new you. And if you know you any other way than the new you, then you don't know you. Don't ask me to repeat that. Favor and openness by Christ Jesus. Not that he did a work and we're out here on the side of him, you know, found somewhere over here going, thank you, Jesus, you did a wonderful work. No, you're the wonderful work. Oh, man. Praise God. All right. But on the other hand, redemption, it frees us. But what does it free us from? All right. Redemption means to be bought or brought out of slavery. I've heard it translated or said it means to be brought out of the slave market. I don't really think that's accurate, and I'll give you some scriptures and reasons why. I think it's close, but I don't think it's accurate, because the slave market, you know, a slave market set up there and they're selling slaves, and Jesus goes, hey, I'll buy them. I mean, that's the literal meaning of redemption, is to be bought. Is that right, Mallory? I mean, aren't you familiar? You know, that's the thing, to be bought. But I think it's to be bought out of the house of bondage, the slavery to the old nature. We'll see a bunch of scriptures that back that up. But we are delivered from the nature that has a tendency toward sin. And when we say sin, folks, we're not just talking about acts and deeds or thoughts or attitudes. we're talking about anything that is not Christ. Now, see, I have to explain that. I'm not saying, you do one thing a day that's Jesus and the rest of it's just sin. I'm not saying that. I'm saying the reality in Christ at the cross is that there is nothing left of the old creation in God's mind and in God's eyes. It's done away. He looks at his son. He sees you there. He doesn't see you outside of Jesus. He doesn't. He doesn't see you outside. You mess up and then you go, and you stand, you go before the Lord and you expect him to go, the reason why you keep messing up is you keep getting outside of Jesus. No, you can't get outside of Jesus if you're born again. You're in him, but you can live as though, or think, here's the important part, but think that you are, and therefore, as a man thinketh, so is he. Well, in this case, if you think that, you're outside of Christ, then you're going to act like it, All right. So redemption frees us from the slavery of that old nature. It frees us from the bondage.
Us and let's see, how do I draw this? I don't want to draw a cat here, but so we'll make that the devil.
It frees us from the written law. Do you see that? That's the Ten Commandments there. It frees us from the written law, and it frees us from, it's not the devil. It's you and me outside of Christ. Surprise! It frees us from the old nature. Amen. Some of you didn't recognize. It's probably like looking in a mirror, isn't it? Yeah, this is. All right. So now when I say it frees us from the written law, again, see, every step of the way, I'm just not making much progress here. But it doesn't mean that that's not valid. It means that it has become more valid by becoming the life and nature of God in you. See, we'll talk about that a little more as we go. But there's no way that you can measure up to Christ, okay? There's no way you can measure up to the written law. Well, I mean, if that's true, then what do we do then? We're all just failures. Amen. Good point. Thank you for that, because that's true. But Christ isn't. And Christ in you isn't a failure. And he is able to fulfill these things. All right. Exodus chapter 13. Should have had mine marked, but I don't. Exodus 13, and I think it's, verse 3. And Moses said unto the people, remember this day to which you came out from Egypt, out of the house of bondage, for by strength of hand the Lord brought you out from this place. There shall no leavened bread be eaten. There shall no leavened bread be eaten. All right. He's talking about their redemption. And in God's mind, In God's mind, I mean, this is it again. You know, we need to get rid of our mind. You know. And, you know, I get in trouble all the time, but I still use the phrases I think of because, you know, when I was first born again, my family, boy, they didn't, you know, oh my God, he's off, he's into some weird thing and all this stuff. And, you know, so I was sharing Jesus with them, and, you know, I was in my early 20s, sharing the Lord with them. They said, you're brainwashed. And I said, I need my brains washed, you know. I said, man, I'm a mess, you know. This is good stuff. I'm, you know, I don't know, a whole lot of things that offend other people just don't mess with me because I go, well, you know, that's right, you know. I need the Lord. All right, so when Israel left Egypt, God described it right here as being redeemed out of the house of bondage. All right, redeemed out of. All right, so let's see if you can follow. Let's see if you can get this. With the subject of reconciliation and the subject of redemption, which comes first? Redemption. Absolutely. Redemption. Because you're being taken out of the house of bondage, and then you're being reconciled to God. Well, we know how we got reconciled to God by Christ, by oneness, by being made after his kind. But being redeemed out of that house of bondage is going to take a particular reality before we really understand redemption in that sense. All right. I have, boy, I don't know, we got 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. I got at least 13 scriptures here that I just looked up real fast that uses the little phrase, house of bondage. I redeemed you out of the house of bondage. You were brought out of the house of bondage. God hardly ever says, I saved you from the Egyptian meanness or something. You know what I mean? I mean, that's, you know, we go, well, you know, I was over there in that land with those people and they were mean to me and Jesus redeemed me. God goes, no. You spiritually were in the house of bondage. Because he always sees everything through Christ crucified. Even 4,000 years earlier at this point, or 6,000, however long, you know, he's seeing Christ crucified. And he says, don't use those present situation terms. The Egyptians did this to me. Don't use that. Then you just get people blaming people. It's the Lord saying to Israel. He says, call it the house of bondage so that you can understand your true state and the true situation that I have brought you out of. Not just, well, I had a poor upbringing and a bad, you know, parental situation and God saved me from my mean parents or something. You know what I mean? Is that it? Really? Is that it? Yes. Amen. For those on Skype, we don't have our regular mics pointing in every direction, but Mallory just said something about God really likes barbecue. I don't know. I'm sure it was great, but just kidding. She shared the Lord as usual, as most of you know, and if you don't know, get online and listen to some of her stuff. All right, so the nation of Israel in Egypt, they were slaves. Okay, they were slaves. What does that mean? They did what their masters wanted. And we're talking about the old nature. We're talking about the house of bondage here. We're talking about the real redemption. That's a shadow. They were slaves. They, and the truth of that is seen in the fact that they cried by reason of the bondage and the work that was put on them and the things that they were doing that they didn't want to do, and they're making straw bricks for Pharaoh, and they're doing all of this stuff. And well, doesn't that sound a little bit like Romans 7? The things that I don't want to do, I end up doing. And it is true bondage. It is bondage to a nature, and that's what the Egyptians represented. We're the master nature, and you're just the vessel. And I, go over there. I don't want to go over there. Go over there. All right, And if you didn't, you got whooped. Sorry, that's probably a Texas phrase. You knew that word, didn't you, Mike? Been whooped. All right, let's go to Galatians chapter 5. Or Galatas, however you... Capitulo 5, verse 1. Galatians 5, verse 1. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. All right, so now... we're seeing that this old nature is bondage. We're seeing that to dwell there and to be controlled by that kind is slavery or bondage. And the apostle is talking to these people in the Galatia area, and he's talking to them about standing fast in the liberty and in freedom wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again. Entangled again. Don't be wrapped up by this bondage thing. All right. So, if you're going to really understand redemption, just the term redemption implies that there's a prior state of slavery or of bondage of some kind. That's, you can't get redeemed unless there was a prior state of bondage or slavery. Okay. Well, most Christians, you ask them what that was, and they'll just talk about their lives. Well, for me, it was cigarettes. For me, it was alcohol. Well, I did drugs, And that was the house of bondage. No, that wasn't the house of bondage. That was just your particular area when you had an Egyptian taskmaster over you in your little area. All right. So, this state, this house of bondage, this state of bondage is totally devoid of liberty or freedom. Okay. Now, you need to believe that whether you understand it or not yet. We'll give you a definition here in a minute. But you need to believe it, because it was for the Israelites in Egypt totally devoid of freedom, liberty, and that sort of thing. Totally devoid. Well, we say, no, I don't know. It is true in God's economy and in the way God looks at it. So my definition of freedom is, we are made free. Freedom is that state that redemption frees us from. That state which redemption frees us from. That's freedom or liberty. You may have to think about that a little bit. Because I did for a long time. I chewed on this. Redemption is being freed from a state of the house of bondage. Redemption is being freed or freeing you from that. And liberty is the state that you now have when redemption has come, because it has freed you from something. Okay, redemption primarily, especially at first, is only about being redeemed from the house of bondage. You're redeemed from hell. You're redeemed from the consequences of sin. You're redeemed from all of that results. None of it itself being the issue. All right. Let me say it in a different way. In other words, freedom is not simply the ability to do what we want when we want. Rather, it is freedom from the particular condition that we were in. Freedom is freedom from the particular condition that we were in. Freedom is being made free from the particular condition in the house of bondage that we were in. When you're free from that, that's freedom. Freedom isn't, I can go anywhere, I can do anything. I'm an American. I'm gonna go to the library. That's not freedom. Freedom is being set free from the state that you're in. Or freedom is not simply the ability to do what you want. Rather, it is freedom from the particular condition that we were in, which, folks, is the old nature or another kind other than Jesus. Being of another kind. All right? Because Jesus walked in this earth. He came down here all by himself. Nobody else was like him, had his nature and anything. He's walking in the midst of constant, you know, temptation and violation and people all having wrong motives and nothing right around him. And he's just fine because he's of another kind. You know, he's not going, oh, Father, you know, there's a man over there with a, you know, and I really would like, you know, he's got an ice cold Coca-Cola and I'd really like it. It's like he doesn't have those pulls. And you know what? He never has. What a choice for putting us in him, or the person. What a choice to be placed in Christ. Because those things are not even there in him, but they're there in us. All right, so that condition was one of doing whatever the old nature wanted when it wanted. Because I say that, I just don't want to, boy. Holy moly. Oh, my God. All right, let me read something here. This means that redemption combined with reconciliation does not just restrict the old nature from its freedoms, but frees the person from the old nature. Frees the person from the old nature that seeks out these freedoms, which are nothing but the desires of an old nature. That person calls being able to do those things freedom. God calls that not freedom, that you need redemption out of the house of bondage. Okay. Just think about it. All right, so for this reason, and I've said this in one of the other classes, redemption and reconciliation and all of those things, they all fall under a great covering. That covering covers all of those things that are under that. That covering is great salvation, as described in the book of Hebrews. Great salvation. Meaning, salvation is not just another term or another way of saying redemption. Is not. Neither is reconciliation or any of the particular things. They all have aspects, but they're not doctrinal aspects. And they're not just truths that some Jesus did something. They all involve partaking of Christ. They must. He can't. We talk about, well, he, you know, now everything's okay. It's not okay if we haven't partaken of Christ. If we're not of his kind, it's not okay. Nothing's okay. Yeah, but he did this fact, and he did this act, and he did this. Yeah, but if we're not seeing the heart of salvation himself, Christ, then we're missing the point. We're missing the real joy of the picture there. All right. So the goal is not for fallen mankind to be free, but to be made free from his old nature. If you just let it make him free, if you turn the old man loose and say, okay, you're free, go, he'll head straight for the bar. You know, I'm just, you know, the coffee bar. No. Just kidding. But I mean, do you see what I'm saying? I mean, if you just turn him free, God's not in the business of just turning Adam free, just turning the old nature free. He's in the business of bringing us into his kind. And the goal is not for fallen mankind to be free, but to be made free from his old nature. Because why? Well, because, you know, the old nature sins and God hates sin. And so this is all about God hating. The plan of God of for saving us is all about God hating. He hates sin. Well, actually, it's about him loving that which is after his kind. And he put us in Jesus of all people, of all ones. He could have sent an angel, even a strong one, and said, here, go down there and just save him from all this stuff. But that wasn't good enough for the Father. He said, I'm going to put you in my Son. You are now accepted, but not on your own merits, only in the Beloved. He could have said, you're accepted in Jesus, and Jesus, or how about this? You're accepted in the Redeemer. But he's showing you the magnitude of his heart for you by placing you in the Beloved. You say, well, what does that Beloved thing mean? Read the Song of Solomon. It'll click something in there. All right, let me make sure So just a reiteration. It is freedom from the slavery of a nature that pulls the person according to the kind which makes up his nature. There is a nature that pulls him. And, you know, again, everybody doesn't have the same syndrome, but they have the same pull. Because it's that kind. All right. So, now, just in closing with that, I'll make a little marker here so I'll know. God, we've really got a long way to go. Anyway, there is a work that God has done that is settled in his heart. And the cross brought it about. And it is that he put you in his Beloved. He puts you in the best place he could think of, the most loved place that he could think of. He puts you in Jesus. And he says, now I know you by Christ, not by you. And at that point, you are of his kind. There is nobody in Christ that is not of his kind. Are you following this? There is nobody in Christ that is not of his kind. Or you wouldn't be in there. Yes. Yeah, he doesn't have any cancer cells. But see, here's the bad thing. You say that, and there's somebody going, well, you don't know about me. I mean, I hear this stuff all the time. And, you know, I do know about you. You're a knucklehead, but you're still in the beloved. And that has not changed and never will change. Right. And that's why the Holy Spirit has to show this. But the goal here, and I'll try to close with this, the goal here is not that in this class we explain doctrine so clear that you get it. It's not. I don't, you know, I really don't care if you don't get this. I care if you have a heart that you want to hear from the Lord pertaining to these things. That's what I'm telling you, that's what I care about. You can walk out of here and meet me at the door and go, Randy, I didn't get a single thing you said. You know, you're sounding like some sort of, you know, alien creature talking up there. That doesn't freak me out. I don't go, oh my God, I failed. No, I'm not the Holy Spirit. But there is a responsibility on your part, and that is to forget about class and forget about Randy teaching, and to draw up close to the Father and say, I would like you to explain this to my heart, not my head. You know? And I just believe that, you know, I mean, it's what he said to me when I was in Bible school. And I said, oh, God, I mean, I just fretted. God, I was a mess, you know, so I know what you go through. But, I mean, you know, I fretted, you know, oh, Lord, I want to know you. I mean, I really want to know you. Please open the word to me. And the Spirit of God says, well, Jesus wants you to see him more than you want to see. But when I realized that, I realized moaning and groaning and begging and pleading really won't get you anything if it's already true. You know, it's like, God, please. He's going, look, it's already done. You know, I mean, there's the house of bondage again. You're in a jail cell. He comes up, unlocks it, and you sit in there, you know, for the next 5 years going, Lord, let me out of here. He says, you know, you're free. All I see is bars. Just believe me and go push on the door. It'll come right open. You know, I hate this lot that I'm being fed in here. You know, that's because you're supposed to be eating, you know, out at a nice restaurant tonight. But you hadn't believed the reality. All right, so we'll stop. We'll take a break.